If you followed my previous video, you should already have an assembled quad. Today we are going to get it flying. Fortunately, you don't need to have any specific knowledge, just follow the instruction in the video. If you are not beginner in FPV, I'm pretty sure that you also find some useful tips and tricks as well as troubleshooting common problems. As flight controller software, I'll be using Betaflight. In my opinion, it's the easiest option for beginners. Go to the download page. And below the release notes, you'll find a link to download the configurator for your operation system. Once you install it, you can connect the drone. If the port isn't detected automatically, select it manually and press connect. If you don't see the port at all, visit the Betaflight troubleshooting page. Also, uncheck the auto-connect function. Believe me, it saves you some nerves and a lot of time in future. On the startup page, you'll see a 3D model of your quad that reacts to your movement. But before we start configuring, let's upload the latest firmware. The current firmware version you will see in top left or bottom right corners. Spoiler, I will roll back firmware version to 4.43 and tell you why a bit later. Now disconnect from configurator and press update firmware button. First, we need to select our flight controller and firmware version. Press auto detect. If it doesn't work, you can manually select UFC from the list. Leave all other settings as default values. One important thing to mention, starting from version 4.4, Betaflight become modular. This means that to enable certain features like GPS or servers, you need to activate the corresponding module. Otherwise, you won't be able to configure or use them. Now click the Load firmware online and then click Flash firmware. Most likely, you'll see the error telling you that the flight controller needs to be put in a boot mode. In order to do this, disconnect the quad from your computer. Find and hold the boot button on flight controller. Reconnect the USB cable while holding the button, then release it. At this point, the firmware should flash successfully. Once it's done, connect to EFC. Place the quad on the flat surface and press calibrate accelerometer. This action helps drone keep the horizon during flight. Then move and rotate your quad in different sides. The 3D model should repeat your movements. If not, most likely you installed EFC in a wrong way. Hopefully, you can fix it through configuration page. In board and sensor alignment page, you can flip the EFC as you need it. Change the values and press Save and Reboot button. After reconnect, make sure that issue with orientation fixed. Let's connect the controller. First, we need to tell the flight controller where we soldered the receiver. Go to the Ports tab in the Betaflight. On this page, we can specify all peripherals connected to the flight controller. Because I soldered the receiver to UART2, I enabled the switch for serial rigs on UART2. Then click Save and Reboot. Next, I want to flash the receiver. Since I'm using ELRS, I need to download the ELRS configurator. Once installed, I select the firmware version and look for my receiver in the device drop-down list. You can flash the receiver over Wi-Fi, but I recommend avoiding this method and flashing through Betaflight instead. I personally ran into issues with older firmwares where flashing over Wi-Fi caused the problems with the link quality. In the configurator, you can also set a bind phrase for your receiver, so it connects automatically without manual binding, but I personally don't like this feature. Finally, select the correct port and press Flash. Most likely, the flashing will fail at the connect stage. The first possible reason that receiver switched to Wi-Fi mode due to inactivity. You can know it by rapid blinking of the LED. If it happens, just unplug and plug the receiver back in. If it still doesn't connect, double-check your wiring and make sure you select the correct port in Betaflight. Once the receiver is successfully flashed, let's bind it to controller. I go to ELRS tab. Then I power the drone twice quickly and leave it powered on the third time. You should see the receiver start double-blinking. This means it's in a bind mode. I press bind on controller and wait for a few seconds. Now it connected. Let's go back to Betaflight. On the receiver page, you can test your controller. The model should react to your sticks and switch movement. If you notice that sticks are inverted, adjust the channel mapping. For example, I swapped the throttle to the right stick. The rest of settings can be left as default values. Since the receiver is connected, let's quickly add some mods. In the Mods tab in Betaflight, you'll find plenty of predefined functions. You can activate each of them by toggling AUX switch on your controller. The first mod we need to configure is ARM. This allows the quad actually fly. If you're using ELRS, it's the best to use AUX1 for arming since it behaves slightly different from other channels. Click Add Range. Instead of manually selecting the switch, you can leave it in auto. Then simply move your switch into desired position. Betaflight will automatically detect it and highlight the range. Now we need to move the slider to cover the highlighted area. I want the quad to arm when my switch in top position, so I hold the switch there and adjust the slider to match. I also like to have angle mode enabled by default. This is useful for testing the quad or in case you lose the video signal. By switching to angle mode, you increase your chances of not losing the drone. Just like we did with ARM, click Add Range on angle mode, toggle the desired switch and set the slider. Feel free to explore other modes on your own. Personally, I like to add beeper to help find the quad in grass and black box for logging flight data. Before moving forward, make sure you've attached an antenna and remove the props. Also, you need a battery. I want to flash the ESCs. By default, they come with BL Heli firmware. I want to upgrade it to bluejay, which enables bidirectional D-shot, a protocol that lets the flight controller know the actual motor speed. This helps the FC filter vibrations more efficiently. Go to the ESC Configurator website and press Connect. Now connect the battery. I strongly recommend you always using a smoke stopper. Also keep in mind that video transmitter powers on immediately and starts heating up, so avoid leaving the quad powered on for too long without airflow. Press Read Settings. You should see 4 ESCs detected. If not, it's likely that the pins inside the ESC or flight controller got bent. Try and plug and reconnect the cable and check the pins. In my case, I see 0 of ESCs. It happened because after upgrading the firmware, the motors protocol was changed. I'm connecting to Betaflight, go to Motors tab and enable bidirectional D-shot. Let's back to ESC configurator. Now all ESCs are detected. Press Flash All. Select the latest version of bluejay, leave the ESC as selected. The PWM frequency is set to 24. Once flashing is complete, press Disconnect. You should hear a new startup tone. Let's go back to Betaflight and open Motors tab. And here I notice some strange problem. There is 100% error rate for motors and they won't work, so something wrong. After debugging, I found that some way on Betaflight 4.5, I constantly get D-shot telemetry and timers errors. The issue was fixed only by downgrading the firmware to 4.4 version. If you know how to fix it in a newer version, drop me the comment. Let's back to motors. We need to configure motors order and direction. In mixture section, you see the schematic visualization of your motor spinning. I like to use Quad X reverse config. Click the Reorder Motors button. After reading and accepting warning message, motors start spinning one by one. You need to point Betaflight which motor spins. Pretty easy. Then we need to make sure that motors are spinning in correct direction. By checking all motors one by one, you can adjust direction by pressing normal or reverse button. To understand the direction, you can gently touch motors with fingers or zip tie. It's kind of hard to fly FPV without video. Likely, setting up the video is one of the easiest configurations. If you try to open the video transmitter tab in Betaflight, you'll notice it's empty. That's because we haven't told the flight controller where the VTX is connected. To fix this, go back to the ports tab. If you remember from previous video, we soldered the data pin to UART4. So I select the correct protocol for the video transmitter. And since I'm using Russian Max Solo, I choose the smart audio. Next, we need to upload the VTX table. It's a special configuration that tells Betaflight how to control the transmitter, including the list of available channels and power levels. You could set up this manually, but it's much easier to download a preset. Go to Preset tab and search for your VTX model. Alternatively, you can upload a config manually through the CLI using a preset file you already have. Once it's done, you'll see the table filled out of the video transmitter tab. The only adjustment I made here was changing low power disarm. Now let's change the channel to A4 and test the video. You may notice there are no information showing on the screen. We can fix it in the OSD tab. Here you can enable whatever feature you want and drag them into any space in our on-screen display. I recommend always enabling RSSI and link quality, so you can always monitor radio connection, as well as battery voltage. The rest of settings are optional. Finally, I want to show you some additional configurations. These are mostly optional but useful. In the config tab, you can set a craft name and display it in OSD. This is helpful when flying with friends. If someone's video feed overlaps with yours, you'll be able to see who's responsible. I always set the arming angle to 180. By default, Betaflight allows you to arm the quad if it's on a flat surface, but sometimes you crash or accidentally disarm mid-fly. Setting it to 180 lets you arm the quad from any position. In the power and battery tab, you can set voltage warnings. When the battery drops below the warning cell voltage, you'll see a low battery message in OSD. Once it reaches the minimum cell voltage, you'll see a land now message. The fail-safe tab, only visible in expert mode, controls how the quad behaves if it loses a signal from your controller. If you installed GPS, you can configure GPS rescue. The quad will return to its starting point automatically. If you don't have GPS, you have the main options – drop or land. In my opinion, land is pretty useless. The quad will lower throttle, but keep gliding forward due to inertia. You can also specify channel fallbacks, which determines sticks and AUX switch positions during the first stage of fail-safe. But what about PIDs, bro? Well, PID tuning and filtering are really advanced topic. Honestly, I will need at least a few hours to cover them properly, and even then, I'd probably fall short compared to explanations from Joshua Barnwell or Oscar Young. So instead, I'll leave you with my current preset, which works for this specific frame and motor setup. If you need other configuration, you can also find expert tuned presets in presets tab. I'll also include links to detailed guides on PID tuning if you want to dive deeper. Unfortunately, it's illegal to fly in Ukraine, so this is my first attempt in a long time. Also, I can't go higher than trees because our air defense troops would immediately punish me. But even at such short fly, the quad felt incredibly responsible and fun to fly. See ya in next videos.